Hey, thanks for this opportunity that we could talk a little bit about the next topic, and that being corporations. You bring some common knowledge into the class, I bet. I bet you've heard of corporations, you know a little bit about them. You've shopped there, maybe you've had a part-time job there, maybe your family works there, maybe your family owns one. You hear about the number of shares traded on the stock exchange, bought and sold every day if you listen to the nightly news. It's a topic you know something about. From an accounting perspective, it's also a topic you know a little bit about, and we can relate it to prior knowledge as we think about this one. Let's talk about the overview. Let's talk about some of the things we're going to talk about and be held responsible for. We'd like to know about corporations. And how they're different from proprietorships or partnerships, which we've covered in the past. Obviously, there are some similarities. There are some differences, some major differences. When we have an owner invest in the business, we give them a share of stock. Initially, we should be curious about what rights that share of stock possesses. We ought to talk about it today. And sometimes there's more than one class of stock. We call it common stock and preferred stock. Students are generally curious about the differences between those two. What makes a share of stock preferred? Let's talk about some of the rights that we would expect a share of preferred stock to have. One of the major objectives is how do we go about issuing stock? When owners invest in the business, our response is to give them shares of stock to represent their ownership claim on the business. We should talk about the journal entries that would be expected of us from the corporation's point of view. There's a different topic related to this broad general one, and that is treasury stock. We need to know what treasury stock is and how it affects us, and perhaps even why we would own shares of treasury stock. We'll talk about that in this segment as well. We need to know these things about the differences and the rights of common and preferred issuing stock and accounting for treasury stock. So let's see if we can get started. One of the ways to see the differences between proprietorships, partnerships, and corporations is to look at the balance sheet, and specifically to look at the capital section of the balance sheet. When we were a proprietorship in first semester, our balance sheet had one owner, one capital account for that one owner. In chapter 12, when we were a partnership, we had two or more capital accounts, one for each partner in the business. And that was the agreement we made. We would have 200 partners with 200 capital accounts. Corporations are distinctly different in the way they report the capital section, the stockholders' equity section of their balance sheet. First of all, the name is different. It's called stockholders' equity, the new name for capital. We've called it owner's equity in the past. We've called it capital. The new name for it is stockholders' equity. See it as the same name, owner's equity. It's being more specific. When we give out shares of stock and they hold those, stockholders' equity. That's the new name for capital. And one of the things we need to know about that is that there are distinctly two sections, two distinct parts of the stockholders' equity section in the balance sheet for a corporation. We need to differentiate between them. It takes us two chapters to cover this material, and that is basically the distinction that we're reflecting in this stockholders' equity section. The first section we call paid in, meaning it came from owners. The paid-in section represents what the owners invest in the business. The second section of stockholders' equity is the retained earnings section. It comes by the efforts of the corporation itself. Those earnings, those profits that are kept in the business become the owner's claim on assets as well. Stockholders' equity is represented of these two major parts: the paid-in section and the retained earnings section of stockholders' equity. This week, our emphasis is on the paid-in section. We're concerned about owner's investment in the business, about the terminology, about the transactions, about the impact on the balance sheet. And next week, we'll turn our attention more to the retained section and answer more of your questions and concern about the nature of retained earnings at that point. Let's talk about issuing stock and the share of stock that's placed in the hands of the shareholders. In first semester, we talked about assets were equal to equities. We had owners invest in the business and we increased their equity account, their capital account. We do that in a corporation as well. The transaction is the same. The way in which we record it, the terminology that we use is distinctly different. When owners invest in the business, we give them a share of stock and ask them to hold on to that share of stock as evidence of their claim on assets. My curiosity at the beginning of a talk like this would be, what rights does that share of stock have? When we give that share of stock to a shareholder, what rights does it have? Let's name them. First of all, the shareholder has the right to vote. Perhaps the most important vote the shareholder would cast would be to elect the board of directors. The board of directors, in turn, is responsible to hire management. And management is responsible to run the company in a way to return wealth to the owner ultimately. So the owner has a stake in this. The right to vote is an important right to vote, so that distinguishes the company and gives the company a way to operate in such a way that they can be profitable. The second basic right we would expect a shareholder to have upon receipt of a share of stock in a corporation would be the right to share in earnings. Now, this shouldn't be a surprise to us. First semester, we were a proprietorship, and the owner got all the earnings. In the chapter we just completed on partnerships, one of our objectives was to determine the division of income among the partners. And we prepared a schedule and made the third step in closing entries based on that. Corporations are no different. Owners who own corporations expect to be rewarded for the profits of the corporation. Those earnings would be shared among the shareholders. The third basic right is a bit more unusual. It's called the preemptive right. The preemptive right is the right that a share of stock has, a shareholder has, to maintain his or her fractional share of ownership in the corporation. Perhaps you've heard about people who own 51% of a corporation and therefore could control it. Well, technically, when shares are widespread, it doesn't take 51%. But no one could argue that a 51% owner would definitely have control of the business. No one could outvote that shareholder. So let's consider that position having a control, or even owning 10% or 5% of the company, as the corporation considers issuing new shares of stock. One of the things that an existing shareholder would want would be the ability to maintain the same fractional share of ownership, the same control that they had before these shares were issued. And a shareholder possesses that right. The preemptive right is the right to receive, to buy, to purchase additional shares of stock from the corporation before the corporation issues those shares to the public at large. In that way, an existing shareholder can maintain his or her fractional share of ownership. It's called the preemptive right. The fourth basic right of a share of stock is the right to share in assets in liquidation. The business belongs to the owners. If the business goes out of business, the owners should get the assets of the business. Now, sure, creditors' claims come first. Assets equal liabilities plus stockholders' equity. But the owners get the residual claim. The owners get what's left. As we contrast corporations with partnerships, that should be a point that is very similar or the same. We worked partnership exercises liquidating a partnership and were very aware that the owners received the cash that remained in the liquidation process.
The same would be true for shareholders in a corporation. We would expect that shares of stock would participate in those assets, would be getting those assets in return for the shares of stock that the shareholders held. Sometimes there's only one class of stock in a corporation. We call it capital stock or common stock. When there is more than one class of stock, often they have different rights and privileges. When one class of stock's rights seem better than others, we call that preferred stock. Generally, students beginning this study are curious about what makes preferred stock preferred. I've chosen just a couple of illustrations. There are many, many distinctions that could be made between the classes of stock that would make them preferred or common. I just thought I'd use a couple of illustrations. One is a right that describes the dividends that a shareholder could expect while holding preferred or common stock. One dividend right is described as participating or non-participating. I don't think we've mentioned dividends before now. Dividends are distributions of earnings. When the corporation is profitable, we said just moments ago that it was a right of the shareholder to receive those earnings. When those earnings are distributed to the shareholders, they're called dividends. And now we're focusing on a dividend right of preferred stock, whether or not it's participating or non-participating. Let's make up a story about two identical corporations, Company A and Company B. They're identical in all ways except the rights that their preferred stock has. Company A has non-participating stock, while Company B's stock is participating. Let's contrast the payment of the dividend by the corporation to the shareholders in these cases. Each of these identical companies has the same amount of money to distribute. They've decided that they have this amount of cash to distribute. The first thing that will happen is that preferred shareholders will get a dividend. Sometimes that's an arbitrary amount. Sometimes that's an amount stated as a percentage of par. Now, I know I'm ahead of myself. I know I haven't described what par is. That comes later in this presentation. But it's an amount printed on the share of the stock. So maybe it's 4% preferred, or 8% preferred, or 7% preferred. It would be that percentage times the par that would be the amount of the preferred dividend. Once preferred shareholders have been paid their dividend, common shareholders would get an equivalent dividend. The distinction between participating and non-participating comes with how the corporation will deal with the leftover amount of cash. What's going to happen to the remainder? If the stock, like in Company A, is non-participating, common will get all of the rest. Preferred shareholders only get their original allotment, and common gets all the rest. In the case of Company B, however, where the preferred shareholders have participating stock, preferred gets the original dividend, common gets an equivalent dividend, and then the preferred and common remainder is shared between the preferred and common shareholders. Preferred gets some, and common gets some. So that's the big difference. Let's see how well you understand this. If you had the choice of owning preferred stock, would you prefer that that preferred stock be participating or non-participating? In class, I'd have you do a show of hands. Since we're not able to do that in this case, how about you just deciding while I pause, and then I'll tell you the right answer. If you had an opportunity to own preferred stock, you would rather it be participating. Not only would you get your original dividend, but you would have the chance to get some of the remainder after common shareholders had been paid. On the other hand, if you were a common shareholder, You would rather that the preferred stock be non-participating. If you were a common shareholder and a dividend was being declared and paid to shareholders, preferred would get their claim first, but common shareholders would get all of the rest. There would be no participating along with the preferred. I hope that makes sense. If not, I hope you'll make a note and ask or look into it a little bit more and get a clarification on the topic. One other right I'd like to use as an illustration to distinguish preferred stock from common stock, some rights that preferred shares might have, would be cumulative and non-cumulative. Cumulative and non-cumulative also describe dividend rights that might be different between preferred and common shareholders. Let's use Company A and Company B as illustrations again. They're alike in almost every circumstance. The big difference that we're zeroing in at the moment is Company A has preferred stock that is non-cumulative. Company B's preferred shares are cumulative. Now, in this case, we're going to use a timeline to describe the dividends that will be paid or won't be paid to shareholders over several years' period of time. Let's pretend that in the first year, called X1, just to label it, there is not enough money to declare a dividend. The board of directors looks at the circumstances, the financial situation of the company, and they decide that it would jeopardize the company to pay a dividend. So they choose not to pay a dividend that year. They're choosing not to pay a dividend even has a name. We call that pass. When a board of directors does not declare a dividend, then they pass the dividend that year. Neither preferred nor common shareholders get a dividend that year. There's also another vocabulary term we should talk about. In the case of cumulative shares, we would describe the corporation being behind on the payment of the dividend to the shareholders as being in arrears. A-R-R-E-A-R-S, arrears, meaning you're behind on the payment of those dividends. Let me distract you with another example. Let's say that my wife and I are shopping for a new home and we're arranging financing. We fill out a credit application, and one of the things that they do to check on our credit is to check with our current mortgage holder. And unfortunately, we're pretending that we haven't made our house payment for the last 3 months. Now, when they check with our current mortgage holder, the mortgage holder is going to say they have 3 months in arrears. They're behind on the payment of those for 3 months. Now, all of that was pretend. We're not shopping for a new house, and we're not behind on our payments, so don't panic. Let's come back and continue the example between companies A and B. They paid no dividends in year one. Now, year two, the board of directors looked at their financial condition again. And in year two, they decided that they don't have the money to pay the dividends. They pass. And because of that, the amount of the dividends increases, the amount of the dividends in arrears increases by the amount of the dividend not paid in year two. The problem continues. In year three, we have a great year and the money comes pouring in. We have enough money to declare and pay dividends to preferred and common shareholders. Let's see how the cash will be allocated because of the dividend in year three. First of all, Company A, whose preferred shares are non-cumulative, will be paid before common. The preferred shareholders will get the amount of cash in that year. I hope you understand the abbreviation. The P colon is for preferred. The dollar amount represents the amount of cash they're going to get for X3, year 3. They get that dividend for year 3 only. And common shareholders get an equivalent dividend for year 3. In other words, the preferred shareholders got nothing for years X1 and X2. Common shareholders get nothing for years X1 and X2. That's in the past. Nothing happened about those. We press on from this point. On the other hand, Company B has cumulative preferred stock. When the board of directors passed in X1, there were amounts in arrears. When the board of directors passed in year 2, the amount in that we were behind on the dividends increased. In year 3, there's enough money to pay a dividend. The preferred shareholders get their dividend for year 1. They get their dividend for year 2. And they get their dividend for year 3 before common shareholders get anything. And common shareholders get only the dividend for year 3. Now, I bet you understand this, but let's apply what you've learned. If you had the choice as a preferred shareholder to have your stock be cumulative or non-cumulative, which would you choose? In class, I'd have you raise your hand. Would you commit yourself to an answer and then I'll tell you what the right answer is? If you had your choice of preferred shares being cumulative or non-cumulative, you would like them to be cumulative. You will get a greater dividend. It's almost a guarantee. There is no guarantee, but it's practically a guarantee that you will get your dividend each year, even if it's not paid to you each year. You will get a year's worth of dividends every year before common shareholders get anything. Now, let's change points of view. If you were a common shareholder, would you like the preferred stock to be cumulative or non-cumulative? If you were a common shareholder, you'd rather the preferred stock be non-cumulative because there would be no obligation to pay them for the past. They would only be in competition with you for the current year's dividends. You would wind up as a common shareholder getting more dividends if that were the case. So we've talked about participating and non-participating, cumulative and non-cumulative. Preferred shareholders also have a preference to assets in liquidation. That should show up in the stockholders' equity section of the balance sheet. If you think about the accounting equation, assets equal liabilities plus owner's equity, we deliberately list liabilities before owner's equity to say creditors' claims come before owners. In that same tradition, as we prepare a stockholders' equity section for a corporation's balance sheet, we will list preferred stock before common stock to indicate that preferred shareholders have preferential rights. If we go out of business, creditors' claims are satisfied first, preferred shareholders' claims are satisfied second, and the remainder goes to common shareholders. I've only mentioned a few of the preferences that preferred stock has. There are many, many others. Once I've raised your awareness level, as you do a little reading in financial journals, as you're aware on TV or in conversations, you may hear other examples of preferences that preferred shares will have. Be on the lookout. One of the drawbacks to preferred stock, we're talking about rights, we're talking about good things that make them preferred. And one of the things we talked about a moment ago was the right that a share of stock had was to vote. Generally, the right to vote is reserved for common shareholders. Preferred shareholders have other privileges, other preferences, but typically they do not have the right to vote. So that's a slight drawback. One of the most important topics we should talk about is issuing stock. Our primary objective this week, there are many, many objectives we would like for you to accomplish, but our primary objective this week is to learn to understand and record issuing stock, placing hands in the hands of the shareholders for the very first time. We need to talk about this transaction from a corporation's perspective. We've done it before. All first semester, in many homework problems, in many exercises, when we began the problem, it would say, owner invested in the business. We debited cash and credited John Doe Capital. Last week in the partnerships chapter, we talked about owners investing in the business. Debit cash, credit John Doe Capital. Debit cash, credit Mary Smith Capital. In other words, we had more than one investment of cash. Corporations are different in this regard. When corporations have owners invest cash or other assets, they accept the asset from the individual, and they give them a share of stock, almost like a receipt, a share of stock to say, here, this entitles you to an ownership claim. Hold this stock as proof that you own this corporation. We have talked about the rights that holding that share of stock have. We need to talk about, from the corporation's point of view, the journal entry that they would make. Let's talk about one point that could be confusing for you. You hear about people buying stock all the time, but it's possible that they're buying stock from someone else who owns stock already issued. That is not the transaction we're recording. If we talk about the Dow Jones average or what the stock market did in a particular day, how many points it went up or how many points it went down, we are not talking about shares of stock being sold from the corporation to the shareholder. Those are marketplace transactions. Those are transactions between existing owners. Our quest is to record the original transaction that allowed all of those marketplace transactions to happen. Ours is the one entry between the corporation and the shareholder, the way in which those shares were actually given out to the shareholders. That's the entry that we're concerned with making. Let's talk about the journal entry necessary when we issue stock. I used a term earlier in this presentation, the term par. Par is an arbitrary amount. Par is an amount that is arbitrarily assigned that is often confused with value. If I were in class, I would hold up a dollar bill right this minute and I would ask the person on the front row what it was. And they would say to the class, it's a dollar bill. And I'd say, it's a 10. And they'd say, no. I'd say, it's a 20. And they'd say, no, it's a 1. I'd say, it's a $50 bill. No, it's a 1. Well, how would you tell? You would look at the dollar bill more closely, and it's got a 1 in four corners and the big word 1 on the back. Well, my analogy breaks down a little bit here, but in the same way that an amount was assigned to a dollar bill and is used to distinguish it one from another, in the same way we would distinguish par from other companies, by what's printed on the certificate itself. Par's arbitrary. The people that start the corporation are often required by the state to assign par. Just because par is 100 doesn't necessarily mean it's worth that. Nor does par of $1 mean it's worth that. $1 stock could sell for much, much more than that in the marketplace. $100 par stock may not sell for $100 in the marketplace. There is no connection between the arbitrary amount assigned to a share of stock by printing it there, par, and the actual value of the stock. That's a hard lesson to learn, a very hard lesson to learn to brand new students in the subject. Now, par has a couple of outcomes for us. From an accounting perspective, par affects what we do in a couple of ways. So let's talk about issuing stock at par for exactly the amount printed on it. We're going to get assets, cash or buildings or land or receivables. We're going to debit those assets and credit an appropriately named equity account. If we have one class of stock, we might call it capital stock. If we have more than one class of stock, we could call it common stock and preferred stock. I'm going to vary the examples that I use in the next little while so that we use all of those titles. But I want you to know that all of them depend on what's being issued. What kind of stock is the shareholder buying? Now, capital stock, common stock, preferred stock, whatever account title we're using, is an equity account, an owner's equity account, a stockholder's equity account. It represents paid-in capital. It represents what the owner has invested in the business. It is owner's equity. Now, we're familiar with this. We've had owner's equity accounts before. We're primarily changing the vocabulary. debit cash for the amount we receive in cash, and credit capital stock. We could possibly sell stock for more than par. This is called selling stock at a premium. When you sell stock at a premium, you debit cash for the amount you receive in cash. You credit an appropriately named equity account. In this case, I use the example preferred stock. For par, we always keep up with stock if it has par. We keep up with stock at par. That's one of the accounting conveniences, the accounting traditions that I mentioned a moment ago. Par has a couple of significant impacts on the way that we do things. And here's one of them. We always keep up with stock at par. Now, since debits and credits had to equal, and since they don't, because we received more cash than we have recorded the transaction at par, we need to credit an account for the difference. We need to make this balance. Get ready for this. The name of that account is paid in capital in excess of par - common stock or preferred stock, depending on the class of stock you're issuing. In this case, I'm assuming preferred stock. Wow, what a mouthful. I think sometimes whoever makes these rules up are just trying to torture principles of accounting students. Paid in capital in excess of par. What kind of an account is that? Well, on the surface, perhaps you'd think it's revenue. You got more than you had as par. Some students think that's worth of the stock. Well, first of all, par does not mean worth. And we determined the worth of the stock by the debit to cash because that was the amount a shareholder was willing to invest. That's what the perceived worth was at that moment. Is paid in capital in excess of par revenue? What a good question. No. Paid in capital in excess of par is a capital account, a stockholder's equity account, a paid in stockholder's equity account. Listen to its name. Paid in capital. Why? Because it came from owners. That's a question I hope you have to answer a lot this week. Why is this account what it is? Well, this is the paid-in chapter. Be on guard. It's our responsibility to account for what owners are investing in the business. And this account, this excess account, is paid-in capital because it came from owners. Let's talk about issuing stock at less than par. It's not covered in great detail in the textbook. Many states have laws that prevent this from happening. Some have the situation that can happen, and I think it's worth mentioning. Issuing stock for less than par is called issuing it at a discount. If you issued stock at a discount, the amount of cash that you received was actually less than the par amount that had been arbitrarily assigned to the stock. So if we debit cash for the amount we receive in cash, we would credit common stock with par. We always keep up with stock at par. And we would debit discount on common stock for the difference to make it balance, plugging it. Discount on common stock is contra stockholders' equity. If we prepared a balance sheet today, we would list it and deduct the balance of discount from common stock to show the true amount, the net amount that owners had invested. Discount on common stock is contra stockholders' equity. There have been abuses with par historically. You can imagine that the villain in the movie that was just had the organ grinder in the background and he was enticing the little old lady to buy $10 par stock for 10 cents per share. Who could resist that? There has been abuse with par over the years. So the accounting movers and shakers and decision makers decided at one point, let's just take care of that abuse by eliminating par. It's possible to have stock that has no par. When you issue stock that has no par, there can be no excess account. You simply debit cash for the amount you receive in cash and credit an appropriately named equity account. In this case, I've chosen preferred stock. Debit cash and credit preferred stock with whatever you receive from the new shareholder. And then the movers and shakers and decision makers in accounting got together in one of those smoke-filled rooms years ago, and they were talking about the past, and they said, "You know, I kind of miss par, don't you?" "Yeah, I kind of miss par too." "Well, let's have something that's kind of like par. Let's don't call it par, let's call it stated value." Oh my. Surely their intent was not to really torture principles of accounting students, do you suppose? We need to know how to issue no par stock that has stated value. Well, in most respects, it works just like par except for a few choice words. Let's pretend that we issued no par stock that has a stated value. We're going to debit cash or cash and other assets for the amount we actually received. Debit cash for what you received. Credit common stock with par if it has par. In this case, it doesn't have par but it has a stated value, so that's like par. So you credit stated value. You credit common stock with the stated value of those shares. And if there is an excess, we would credit an account called paid in capital in excess of stated value - common stock, or preferred stock, common stock in the illustration I'm using here. So it's very similar, don't you see? Always keep up with stock at par or at stated value. Use an appropriately named excess account, paid in capital in excess of par if it has par, or paid in capital in excess of stated value if it has stated value. And paid in capital in either case, par or stated value, is an additional investment by the owner. If you're preparing a balance sheet and an income statement, it goes on the balance sheet. It goes in the stockholders' equity section. It's an addition to the amount of par stock to reflect the true amount that owners have invested in the business. Your homework assignments in these two chapters ask you to prepare a stockholders' equity section almost every time. Find a good example in the book. And make sure you're providing in your solution the details similar to those described in the illustration. First of all, you ought to put on a good attitude. When you're doing a stockholders' equity section, it's not a brand new financial statement, but simply a part of the balance sheet. The authors realize that you don't have to write down all the old things on the balance sheet that you're already supposed to know. You could put a good heading on it. You could pretend that you did the asset section. You could pretend that you finished the liabilities section. And then you're ready to prepare the stockholders' equity section. And, again, use a good example. List preferred first. List common afterwards. List other paid-in items. Retained earnings comes after the paid-in section. We'll learn more about that next week. Be sure that you distinguish between the two distinct sections. Have a total for paid-in. Add the total of retained to get total stockholders' equity. Add total stockholders' equity to total liabilities in real life to get the balance sheet to balance. That sum should be the same as the asset figure. Use a good example in the book to follow. Under the broad umbrella of stock transactions, we should talk about treasury stock. Treasury stock's different than anything we've encountered to this point. Let's talk about what treasury stock is. Treasury stock is stock of our corporation that we issued and recorded because we got assets from a shareholder. They either put in cash or they put in other assets, and we made that entry that we talked about just in the last section of this illustration. We debited cash and credited common stock, or debited cash and credited preferred stock. We issued those shares of stock because we got assets of the business. But somehow, we got those shares of stock back. The most common way to get those back would be to buy them back, to go out in the marketplace and buy our own shares of stock. And when we bought them back, we didn't cancel them. We didn't reissue them. We put them in a safe place, in a separate pile from other non-issued shares that we have. But we still have them. One more time. Treasury stock is stock of our corporation that we've given out. Somehow we got them back, And when we got them back, we didn't tear them up, and we still have them. Well, sometimes we need to think about some parallels to truly understand what treasury stock is. So let's pretend that there are two similar corporations, one named XYZ Corporation and one named ABZ Corporation. And XYZ Company has more cash than they know what to do with. Is it okay for XYZ to buy shares of ABC Company? I hope you answered that question to yourself already. Can we go out in the marketplace and buy another corporation's stock? Can Pepsi go out and buy Taco Bell? Can Pepsi go out and buy Kentucky Fried Chicken stock? Sure. Corporations can own all or part of other corporations. Absolutely, yes. Now, if we, XYZ Company, bought ABC shares of stock, what would those shares of stock be while we were holding them? Would they be assets, liabilities, capital, revenue, or expense? You are deciding on your own, aren't you? If we bought ABC shares and held them ourselves, those would be assets to us, just like equipment would be an asset, or land would be an asset, or buildings would be an asset. We could invest in another business. Those are assets. Now, that's a parallel that I'm trying to draw to get you understand what happens if we, XYZ Company, go out into the marketplace and buy some of our own shares. Can XYZ Corp go buy XYZ Corp stock? Yes, we can. And if we go and buy those shares and hold those shares ourselves, what is it? The question is it an asset? And the answer is, it is not. A few moments ago, I talked to you about the word definition of what treasury stock was, and I don't think you fully understood it. I didn't expect you to from having heard it the first time. Sometimes it's easier to understand what treasury stock is by considering what treasury stock isn't. Treasury stock is not an asset. You cannot own yourself. You cannot go out and buy your own shares and hold them for yourselves. Treasury stock is not an asset. It does not have the right to vote. It does not have the preemptive right. It does not have the right to share in earnings. It does not have the right to share in assets in liquidation. All of which are rights we've talked about in this presentation. Treasury stock really is a return of capital to the shareholders. That definition reminds me of dividends. In this presentation, we talked about distributing earnings. The name of a corporation distributing earnings to the shareholders is a dividend. But when a corporation goes out and buys treasury shares from specific people, they're returning capital to the owner like a dividend, but not everybody benefits like everybody benefits when it's a dividend. We're returning capital to those specific shareholders from whom the treasury stock was purchased. Treasury stock is a return of capital to the shareholders involved in the transaction. It's not an asset and has no rights. There is an account called treasury stock. Treasury stock is contra stockholders' equity. It's a deduction right at the very bottom of the stockholders' equity section, the last thing you do before the grand total. You subtract out the cost of the treasury shares, what you paid for them. We account for treasury stock at cost, not par. We account for the original issue of stock at par, if it has par, or stated value, if it has stated value. But this is buying the shares back. When you buy the shares back, you account for it at cost. Let's make some journal entries. If we went out into the marketplace and bought some of our own shares of stock, we would debit the account called treasury stock and credit cash. We are returning capital to the owner. Now notice that we're not tearing up the stock. We're not canceling it. If we were tearing it up or canceling it, we'd be debiting common stock right now. These shares are still issued, but they're no longer in the hands of the shareholders. They're not outstanding anymore. We would debit the contra equity account, treasury stock, and credit cash. Later, if we had the opportunity to sell some of these shares of stock, we might sell them for more than we'd paid for them. If we did so, then that's an owner investing in the business, but it's not the original issue of the stock. We would debit cash for the amount we received. Instead of crediting common stock, we're crediting treasury stock because we're no longer holding these shares of stock. These are not new shares being issued. They're already accounted for in the common stock account. We're crediting treasury stock to reduce it. If we get more than we paid for these items, we would credit paid-in capital from sale of treasury stock. If that were the original issue, it would be in excess of par. But this is additional owner's investment, additional paid-in capital from owners because we sold these shares of treasury stock for more than we had purchased them, for more than cost. That doesn't cover all the topics that we need to know about treasury stock. Usually, treasury stock makes students very curious. I'm hoping that you'll read in the book and perhaps read from other sources about why a corporation would choose to go out into the marketplace and buy their own shares. There are some good, legitimate reasons for doing so. Let's take a flashback real quickly at the things we've talked about today. How are corporations different from proprietorships and partnerships? We've seen some big differences. What are some of the rights of stock? Four basic ones, some additional ones that preferred shares have, cumulative, non-cumulative, participating, and non-participating. There were lots of things important today, but perhaps nothing was more important than understanding the basic entries for issuing stock, debiting cash, and crediting common stock. Common stock is a new name for what was the equivalent to John Doe Capital in the past. But for corporations, we keep up with paid in and retained separately. And these are paid in transactions because they came from owners. And finally, we talked about accounting for treasury stock, what it is and what it isn't, and how to record buying it back and how to record selling it. I'm hoping that you understood most of the things that we did today, and I'm hoping that you'll do your homework soon and that your homework would be easier for you because you listened and watched this video. Thank you for your time. I'll see you soon.